Traveling to new countries always leaves me wondering about some of the very basic things in life. This time, while I was in France, I put to test all the little French I learned at school. Something finally made sense. I realized why my teacher gave up on training me with a French accent. Why isn't the intro rolling?
Why are you in my room?
You called me here, Adwa.
No, I didn't. Anyway, let's just go to the intro.
I'm Nishka, and tonight on Creatures of the Night, I'm going to be talking about the science of accents. Let's start by talking about what an accent is. An accent is defined as a distinctive way of pronouncing a language, especially one associated with a particular country, area, or social class, which is very different from a dialect, which is basically a change in not only the accent, but also the grammar and vocabulary of the people of the certain region. So technically speaking, the switch of certain words, such as pants becoming trousers, or chips becoming crisps, is due to change in dialect and not accent. The study of accents is called sociolinguistics, and the basic unit of studying this is understanding phonemes. Phonemes is a basic unit of sound, and when they're put together, they make words. In the English language, there are 26 letters but 44 distinctive phonemes. Most foreign languages do not correspond to these sets of phonemes. For example, Germans don't have the ability to say the, such as the word that, thus they end up saying zat, while Japanese don't have the ability to differentiate between la and ra, as this is not there in their languages. Therefore, they replace it with phonemes that they are familiar with, thus making it sound completely different, changing the pronunciation and forming the Japanese accent. It's not only individual sound that can cause a person's speech to sound foreign. Sound patterns also differ from language to language. For instance, an English syllable may begin or end with the cluster of consonants, as in the word strength, where it begins with stra and ends with. In Japanese, on the other hand, a syllable contains only one consonant followed by one vowel, such as in ma or chi. For this reason, pronouncing English consonant clusters is hard for Japanese speakers, and they may pronounce a vowel sound between the consonants in the cluster. The same way, pronouncing French vowel clusters can be difficult for native English speakers. Finally, sentence structure differs from language to language as well. In Russian, for example, it's not necessary to have connecting words like is or the. Therefore, the sentence, the house is very large, would probably correspond to house very large in Russian. Let's take an example of the typical American and English accent difference. Incorrectly portrayed in modern movies, the Patriots and the Redcoats spoke with accents that were much closer to the contemporary American accent than to Queen's English. In the 1700s, whether you were American or British, your pronunciation would have been pretty much the same. It is this standard British accent that has drastically changed in the past two centuries, while the typical American accent has only subtly changed. Traditional English was largely rhotic. Rhotic speakers pronounce the R sound, such as in the words hard and winter, while non-rhotic speakers do not. In the British upper class, this shift occurred because people with a low birth rank who had become wealthy during the Industrial Revolution were seeking ways to distinguish themselves from other commoners. Thus, they cultivated the prestigious non-rhotic pronunciation in order to demonstrate their new upper-class status. Thus, the accents divided into American accent called General American and the British accent called Received Pronunciation. To understand this better, let's look at a study where 32 American and 32 Japanese kids listened to recordings playing La 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 and every once in a while La La Ra. Differentiating a La from a Ra would result in a toy playing a happy melody. It was seen that both sets of 6-month-old babies could differentiate, but when the same experiment was tried on 10 to 12-month-old babies, they could not successfully differentiate. This suggests that the Broca's area of the inferior frontal gyrus, which is concerned with speech formation, develops as early as that age, and the understanding of phonemes is already established. This makes it very clear that changing your accent to the exotic one of your preference is a very difficult task. This is where the foreign accent syndrome comes into the picture. There are strange cases where people with some sort of head injury wake up and communicate in a completely different accent. Foreign accent syndrome is caused by brain damage to the insular region, which impairs the control of the muscles used to produce speech. Research has shown that people with the foreign accent syndrome nearly always have trouble producing vowels. Brain damage affects their ability to control their tongue movements. There may be too much or too little tension, and therefore they may undershoot or overshoot their target pronunciation. This leads to the vowel sounding completely different. This, along with problems in stress pattern of words and rhythm and intonation of the sentences, sometimes may sound like a completely different accent. This brings us to the end of our episode about the science of how accents evolve and how they are studied. So the next time you see a non-native English speaker attempt to learn English, think about how it might feel to not be able to differentiate between the very sounds that form the language, let alone learn the language and help them out. Alright, we hope you found this video interesting. If you want to check out some more cool content, you can click here. Or if you want to subscribe, you can click subscribe. We'll see you in the next video. Until then, good night, sleep tight, and don't let the C-Mix look hilarious. Bye.